Lord, for his goodness and his mercy. What I want to do on today is to take a look at this idea around prayer. Prayer in a very practical way. Of course, we know prayer as being conversation with the Lord. Conversation with the Lord. And oftentimes, when we pray, we want to see results, don't we? Absolutely. We want to see results. We want to see that our prayers have been answered, and whatever was addressed or whatever was mentioned in that prayer, we're hoping that the Lord will answer. But sometimes what we have to realize and understand is that when we pray, we may not always get the result right away. We may not always get the result right away. And sometimes it may seem that the Lord is not going to answer. But the truth of the matter is that sometimes in life, you know, we have to learn how to be patient.
Amen.
We have to learn how to be patient. We have to learn how to not only be patient, but allow our faith to grow and to develop. Now, when you look at prayer, all right, there's something I want to introduce today. It's called the prayer productive zone. The prayer productive zone. And when you think about the prayer productive zone, okay, being the word zone, a zone is simply a place where your problem interacts with the solution. All right, the zone is where the problem interacts with the solution. Now, another name in the zone for the problem is called the disequilibrium, as I have here. The disequilibrium, all right, or the imbalance. Disequilibrium, the problem, the imbalance. Okay. And then the other thing is called, as I said, the solution. The solution, or another name for the solution, is the equilibrium. The equilibrium. Another name for equilibrium would be balance. And the challenge in our life sometimes is that we have these two concepts existing, where you have something that is imbalanced, and then sometimes you have that which is what? Balanced. And so the challenge in life is to identify those areas in our life that are out of balance, that are in a disequilibrium, a place in our life that is problematic. And oftentimes when we identify those areas in our life that are problematic, we identify those areas in our life that are imbalanced, okay? Typically, that tends to be the topic of our prayer, doesn't it?
Amen.
Because oftentimes when we go to the Lord in prayer, we go to Him with areas of concern that we need help with, okay? And so I said a few moments ago, when we pray to the Lord and ask Him to help us, Lord, help me, Lord, in that disequilibrium in my life. Help me in that area where I am imbalanced, where something in my life is not where it should be.
I need you to help me with that. And so after we get up from the prayer, sometimes we want instant results.
Amen.
But sometimes that's not always the case. Because when we get up from that prayer, what we have to realize and understand is that there is a prayer productive zone. In other words, there is a place where that prayer has to go through the ups and the downs of everyday life. Because life, once you finish praying, life still happens. The reality that you had before the prayer, for the most part, when you get up, guess what? The reality is not going to change.
Instantaneous.
But it has to go through. Now, you remember your clock diagram? It has to go through those five cycles of what? Time, choice, effort, emotions. Then what? The fifth is the reality. The reality. Now, remember what we talked about with that clock, okay? You have 12, 3, 5, 7, and 9. All right? 9 o'clock is your reality. Remember that? 9 o'clock is your reality. Oftentimes what happened is, and of course, you know, this is time. I'm just going to abbreviate. Time, choice, effort. EM stands for emotions at 7 o'clock, and 9 o'clock represents your what? Reality. Oftentimes, what we want to happen is once we finish, we want our reality to immediately change. But here's the key. You got to work the clock.
Amen.
Which means you got to put in work. You got to take the time to make the right what? Choice. Once we pray, once you finish that prayer, get up, all right, and work your clock. Work your choices. After you make a choice, put forth what? Effort. Because listen, you have to play a part also in bringing balance back into the area in your life that is out of balance. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
You have got to put forth a conscientious effort to help bring balance back into that area of your life.
Amen.
And so once we see what you have to realize and understand is that oftentimes what happens is that we want to focus immediately back this way on the reality. But see, when you focus back on the reality, what direction are you going in? You're going what? Counterclockwise. But you got to go what? Clockwise. Because when you go clockwise, what are you doing? You're moving time what? Forward. You see? And so then the key is understanding what the problem is. What is the imbalance in my life? All right? Then once I pray about it, then once I finish praying, I got to get up. And then I got to make sure I'm making the right choices.
Amen.
I'm doing my part in answering my own prayer, you see. And so then as you make those choices, as you put forth the physical effort, then what happens, and then what you see, your emotions begin to fall in order. And then what happens is you realize that your reality is finally beginning to change. But now here's the thing. Your prayer goes through, and this is the interesting part here. Your prayer goes through these parts here in the zone. You've got 4 parts in this zone here. All right. And this is real, especially when you start dealing with the 7 o'clock, which is your what? Emotions. Yeah. Sometimes life can be called an emotional roller coaster. Absolutely. And when you're in that prayer productive zone, you've already prayed. You've already released the prayer into the atmosphere. But now what has to happen is now you have to get on, you have to enter into the zone. Just like when you go to an amusement park and you enter into a roller coaster. Well, after you release that prayer, you have to enter into what is called the prayer productive zone, where your prayer is becoming productive. You don't see the reality change yet, but you know that it's working. And so as you release your prayer into the productive zone, it's going through these four components the upswing. All right. And of course, in the upswing, what are you doing? You're what? You're gaining momentum. You're going what? You're going up. All right. You're sending that prayer what? Up. Absolutely. But then it gets to the what? Peak. That's the second component, the peak. And then after it reaches the peak, then you have to go through what? The downswing. The downswing. Hmm? But here's the key here, is that as you're going up, the momentum that you have going up should be strong enough that once you hit the peak, it takes you through the downswing, all right? All right, now as you enter to the downswing, you're going into the what? Which is the fourth component, the what? The valley, which is the low point here. But you don't stay there, do you?
No.
But what happened? At the downswing, it takes you into the valley, but then it takes you immediately what? Right back up into the upswing. And so with those four points there, the emotional part, the emotional side of who you are embarks upon that journey. And it's real. It's like life is an emotional roller coaster. You're up. You reach the top, you feel like you're doing a little something. But as soon as you feel like you're doing a little something, here comes the downswing. And I believe it's designed that way. It's designed that way so that we don't get conceited up here.
Amen.
So that we don't get full of ourselves up here. God sends in what? The downswing. To let us know that this is temporary here. That you enter into the downswing. And so as you hit that downswing and you enter to that low point, sometimes your emotional state is what? You're at that low point. Absolutely, yes. That's a part of life. But you don't stay there. But what? You're back on the up again. And so then, what you realize, what you see here, then, is that life is like a roller coaster. And all this time, that prayer has been released. But as that prayer is being released again, you still do what? Life still happens. Life still goes on. Even after you said amen. Even after you've gotten up from off your knees or home, or however you choose to pray, life still happens. It still goes on. And so then, as you go through here, all right, ultimately what you want to see, at the end of the process, you want to see what? Change.
Yes, Lord.
But that change is not going to occur until after you what? You've experienced the emotional roller coaster that life has for you. And see, you can take this model and you can put any area in your life into this zone. You can put your finances in this zone. Absolutely. Your money. Yeah, absolutely. You can put your relationships in this zone. Absolutely. Your relationships are going to experience bumps in the road. You can put your occupation in there. Everything is not going to always go like you wanted on your job. And so then you're going to experience the ups and downs on your job. Students, you will experience this in your academic endeavors. From middle school, high school, college, this is life. But you have to establish, you have to have that prayer. You have to have that communication with God. You have to have that devotional time with Him. Because what ultimately happened is, over the course of time, as you're experiencing this up and down mental, emotional roller coaster, take a look at the example here, what's happening over the course of time. Where the imbalance or the problem, which starts out up top, and of course you're down here at ground zero, over the course of time, as you're what? As you're progressing through this emotional roller coaster, this prayer productive zone, you are being productive. That's the key. Be productive. Because as you're being productive over the course of time, what is happening? You're what? You're on the what? Upswing, aren't you? And your imbalance is on the what? Downswing. You see that? It starts out up here. But it gradually what? Moves its way what? Down until you what? Intersect or meet right there at the point of intersection, at the point of meeting. So with that being said, I want us to take a look at a real practical example real quick here in Genesis 32. Genesis 32 here. All right. And so the challenge this morning, again, is to identify what area in my life is currently in a disequilibrium. It's in a problematic state. There is an imbalance there. Identify what that problem is. And be honest. And we all have an imbalance. We all do. But the key is bringing what? Balance into the picture. So with Jacob, let's look at it. Let's look at that for just a moment. All right. In Genesis 32 here. All right. Genesis 32. Starting point here in our story. Down here is Jacob. And of course, we know with Jacob, there have been some relationship strains for him within his family, more specifically. With his brother Esau. And so for him, for Jacob personally, that relationship with Esau was problematic. And so we're going to write Esau here across the top. And so for a while, you know, it's like that problem, it hangs over your head, you know. And in this diagram, we can see that where Jacob is down here, but that relationship, that past relationship with his brother, is like it lingers over his head. Anybody ever have lingering issues?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
And sometimes, you know, when something lingers, you get tired of it. You say, you know, I'm sick and tired of this. I'm getting ready to do something about it. Let me give just a simple example. We had our ministry. We bought a karaoke machine some years ago that we utilized at the camp meeting. And of course, it was brand new. It started out working just fine. Course. But then over the course of the years, I began to wear out. And so I attempted on two occasions to fix it and took it to the shop, had it fixed, and got it back. It would work sometimes, and then sometimes it wouldn't. I remember one particular camp meeting, it stopped working, so we had to utilize the CD player in the van. We had to raise the hatch on the van and play the CD through the van. And so, there was a couple other events where we connected a microphone into the PA, and then we used a little small boom box, and we sat there and held the microphone up to the small boom box so that we could play the CD music through the PA system. And it was just becoming problematic, and it was becoming a distraction. And so this year, it became like a lingering issue. And so this year, I'm not going to invest any more money in it. I'm going to go and I'm going to look for something else. look for something. And some, and that's not, when you have that, when you have something in life that gets on your nerves, you invest time in it, you try to fix it up, you know, and so you say, I'm going to do something different. I'm going to do something different. And sometimes that's what we have to learn, how to do something different, you know. Now, of course, now, in that example, okay, when you got something a little bit more modern, a little bit more technical advanced, so hopefully it should be a little bit more what convenient. Now, you can do that with the machine. Now, listen, if an area in your life is a relationship, now you can't go replacing people now. I was just giving you that example as a machine as to if something is getting on your nerve, rather than continually trying to do, you change your mindset to do something different, which means when you're dealing with people, that which means sometimes you have to change your mind as to how you deal with people when you're in problematic relationships. Does that make sense? You have to change your mindset. You have to change your thinking. You have to change your approach. And when you change your approach about something, just like I finally decided to go and get something new physically, well, sometimes you have to learn how to change your mind mentally and move to a new level of thinking.
Amen.
About that problematic area in your life. Because sometimes problematic areas in your life are not physical. Amen. It's not a physical concept. It's a spiritual concept. Which means then, sometimes, like Paul says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye what? Renewed. Be not conformed to this, but be ye renewed. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing.
Thank you.
So transformation comes only when there is what? A renewal of your mind.
Amen.
Just like I got a new karaoke, you have to get a new mindset around those things that are problematic in your life, that are subjective in nature. See, my example with the karaoke machine was objective because I was dealing with what? With an object. But some areas in our life are subjective. In other words, it's not about an object, it's about a subject. And so sometimes in our relationships, the root or the subject matter, the root cause of our relationships or suffering, the subject should be about what? Communication. Communication. How you communicate. Relating. How do you relate to the individual? You see, I'm talking about relationships for a moment. So then, in that, being able to identify those areas and understand what needs to change, what needs to be a little bit different. Does that make sense?
Amen.
So in our example here with Jacob and Esau, we're dealing with the subject matter here, okay, of relationships. So for Jacob, we see here in chapter 32, all right, he was preparing himself to meet his brother for quite a bit, and it's been... it has been some time since they had met. And so Jacob's concern was that his brother was going to be still upset about what he did to him in the past. Okay? So what we see, look at Genesis 32 for a minute if you would. All right? And it says there in verse 3, it says, and Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau his brother unto the land of Edom. All right. So it says he sent messengers. Now, look down at verse 4. And he commanded them, saying, thus shall ye speak unto my lord Esau. So he was sending people to speak on what? On his behalf.
Amen.
See, sometimes when you have relationship problems, you don't send people to speak on your behalf.
No, you don't.
You speak for yourself,
come on, man.
With the individual.
Amen.
Or individuals that you are having problems with. I'll send someone else on your behalf.
No.
You see. And so he sent messengers before them. And so it says that, and so when they came back from talking with Esau, verse 6, look down at verse 6. And the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, we came to your brother Esau, and he came to me, and also he cometh to meet thee with 400 men. Now, verse 6 right there. So Jacob was already nervous. That made him even worse. 400 men. And see, you know, that's how the enemy he'll do. He'll magnify things and make them seem worse than what they really are, you know.
Amen.
So he said 400. So in Jacob's mind, he's like, oh, 400 men. He's coming to do me some harm here. And in verse 7, look at what it said. And Jacob was what? He was afraid. He was distressed. Like I told you a few moments ago, that karaoke machine was getting on my nerves. Stress. I shouldn't have that level of stress when it comes time to doing an event. I should be able to put my CD in there, and the machine needs to play. You know? So if that's the desired option that I want, and I realize that what I have is not giving me what I want, then I need to what? Go get something that is. You gotta what? Change your mindset. Lord have mercy. Academically, if you're not getting the grades that you want, then you gotta what? Change your mindset so that you can what? Get what you want.
Amen.
Otherwise, guess what? You're not gonna get it. You're not gonna get those grades you're desiring unless you do what? You gotta change your mind and do probably what you haven't done in order to get what you've never gotten.
If that makes sense.
Yes.
So Jacob was afraid down there in verse 7, y'all. He was down here. Down here in Genesis. What chapter is that? 32. 32?
Huh? Yes.
Verses 3 and 7.
Yes, sir.
3 actually 6 and 7 lets us know. He was a nervous wreck. Somebody say nervous wreck.
Nervous.
Have you ever felt like a nervous wreck?
Yes, Lord.
A nervous wreck. A nervous wreck. Money is a nervous wreck. Relationships are nervous wreck. Job getting on your nerves. It's a nervous wreck. Your children. Your husband, your wife, your grandma, your grandpa, your family, your sister, your brother, everybody. Everything's just a nervous wreck.
Yes.
Ministry's not going right. Church members, everything's a nervous wreck. So he was afraid, and so he began to divide his stuff up. Divided stuff up, and as he was dividing them out, verse 8 said, now if Esau come to one company and smite it, then I'll have something left. That was his mentality. Doing all this now. Trying to what? Trying to bring balance. Lord have mercy. Trying to bring balance to an imbalanced situation. Trying to figure it out. And see, that's what we was trying to do. With that old karaoke. Well, let's just grab the little boom box, sit it on the table, then we'll get a microphone and hold it up to the little boom box and let the sound project out of the big PA system. No, just go get something. Do something different. So Jacob sitting here trying to figure it out. Then he wised up a little bit. He wised up a little bit in verse 9. So he thought, you know, he was here. And as he's split that in verse number 8, really, for him, he thinks he's moving up a little bit by splitting up these companies here. Think he's gonna have something left. But look, him splitting up his stuff is not going to fix the problem. Because he's still got the lingering issue with his brother. See, you got to differentiate your stuff from what the root cause, from what the root is.
Yes, Lord.
You see. Now, verse 9 said, and Jacob said, oh God! So finally, he wised up a little bit and started what? Having a conversation with the Lord. And that's the beginning of his prayer. Oh God! Of my father Abraham. Oh God! Of my father Isaac. The Lord which said to me, return unto thy country and unto thy kindred, and I will deal what? Well, now it's interesting there. In his conversation here, he's basically giving God a rehearsal of what God has already, you know. God, who you are, he's reminded, Lord, you're the God of Abraham, God of Isaac, which said to me, return unto thy country and unto thy brethren, and I will what? Do well. It's almost like in verse 9, he's feeling this anxiety down here, and he's reminded God, now God, you told me now to return home. But in Jacob's mindset, he still got what? That lingering issue. He said, verse, I'm not worthy of the least of all thy mercies and of all the truth which thou hast shown unto thy servant. For with my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now I have become two bands. Verse 11, right here, is where the problem and the solution do what? Intersect. Verse 11, deliver me, verse 11, he says, I pray thee from the what? Hand of my brother. The deliverance is the solution, isn't it? That's what he's looking for. Who is he looking for deliverance from? And it says it right there. From the hand of my brother. Deliver me. That's the prayer. He's sending that prayer up to the Lord, saying, Lord, help me. Now, verse 11 also says, for I what? For I fear him. Jacob is being honest right there. He's being honest right there. At this point right here, you got to be honest.
Lord, have mercy. Help me.
At the point where the problem and the solution interact with one another, you've got to be honest with yourself and know where you are. Amen. He says, I fear him. I'm fearful. Fear is problematic for me. In that area that is problematic right now in your life, own up to what your role is in it.
Preach.
What is your role in it? And you've got to be honest enough with yourself to say, this is what I'm struggling with that's causing this area in my life to be problematic. See, and when you're in the prayer productive zone, there's no time to put on no mask and put on no masquerade. No, when you're in the prayer productive zone, it's a place of honesty. It's a place of conversation. God already knows what you have need of before you even ask him. The challenge is, are you willing to be honest enough with him and put it on the table?
Amen. Preach. Woo. Yes.
He already knows that Jacob is fearful. But Jacob, do you know that you're fearful? Do you know that you're arrogant? Do you know that you're selfish? Do you know? That you're hard to relate to. Do you know that people can't talk to you without you flying off the handle? Do you know that you're not approachable? Do you know that your attitude needs some work? Do you know?
Oh, Lord Jesus.
I know I'm stepping on toes, but I'm stepping on my own toes. Listen, I take my shoes off and put my toes right out there. Lord, step on them. I'd much rather Lord step on my toes than to bury my toes. That's what happens when you don't utilize wisdom. The God. If you're not careful, that area in your life is going to die. Hear my toes, boy. Step on them. Don't bury them. Step on them. Step on them. Here. Step on them. He says, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite me and the mother of my children. So at this point now, Lord have mercy. When you become honest, now God says, I should do something with you. Why? Because you notice you don't have it all together. You thought you did up to this point. All what has it gotten you? But when you become honest with him, now where the two intersect, now you really begin to see what's happening here. Yes. He's on Jacob is what? On the upswing, and his problem is what? On the downswing. Put it in motion. So verse 11, he released the prayer. Now it's going what? Into the productive zone. Now it's going into the productive zone. Now watch this here. Even after he releases it into the productive zone, he's still working. He's still trying to figure it out. So he goes on down here, verses 12, 13, 14, 15. He goes ahead and he divides his stuff up and he sends a gift ahead. Hoping that it's gonna work, as he's still trying to figure it out, and as he's trying to come up with his own plan, God's working too.
Amen.
Yeah, he is. Life still goes on. He's still fearful. He's still Lord. What did I tell you? After you finish the prayer, when you get back up, sometimes you're gonna still have to face the reality that you had before you went into the prayer. So skip all over there to verse 20. He said, now listen. This is what you do. You send all this stuff over. Now look here. This is what Jacob hoped. He said, verse 20. For he said, I will appease my brother with the present that what goes before me. That what goes before me. Now I'm getting into something now already. So you look at today and say, you better know who your forerunner is. Know who your forerunner is. Know who you sending before you. That's for another whole conversation. I'm working on that. You gotta know who your forerunner is, who you sending before you. Why? Because the purpose of the forerunner is to pave the way for you. You don't want stuff paving the way for you. No. Stuff is objective. No. You want something that's subjective, that has the capacity to pull down strongholds before you even get the canvas. To do warfare before you even arrive to the job. You want the atmosphere already conducive to productivity. Say, know who your forerunner is. Know who your forerunner is. Know who you're sending before you. Know who you're sending before you. Know who your John the Baptist is. Know who your John the Baptist is. You better get you a John the Baptist that knows what his purpose is, knows what his calling is. He said, I will appease him with the present that goeth before him, and afterward I will see his face. Maybe. No. Know what you're sending before you. Because what you're sending before you, you should be confident enough, not in a maybe, but in a yes. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Jesus. Lord have mercy.
So we see right there in verse 20 that Jacob is struggling because he said, maybe. Why is he saying maybe? Because he's sending forth the wrong stuff. So verse 21, it says, so went the present over before him. And so, as it goes on, it says, verse 24, it says that, now verse 24 is key. Verse 24 is key. Well, verse 24 takes him right to right here. Now he's shown up, as the elders used to, shown up. He's at the threshold of entering into what? The prayer productive zone. He's getting ready to enter into it. Now, how do I know that? Verse 24 says, and Jacob was what? Left alone.
Alone.
Stop trying to take everybody into your productive prayer zone. That's the problem. You're taking too many folk into your productive prayer zone and they got problems of their own. You got to go into your productive prayer zone for yourself. You got to go in it by yourself.
Amen. Lord Jesus.
He was there alone and there wrestled a man what? With him. Verse 24 represents the answer to verse 11. Verse number 24 represents the answer to verse 11. He said, Lord, deliver me. Now, when we pray, we can't be choosy around the method that God chooses to.
Come on now. Reach.
If you want the Lord to help you, then you got to give him. You got to give him the rights to your life to mix things up as to how he sees fit.
Amen.
So in this particular instance, the Lord chose to send a man to wrestle with Jacob. So Jacob is what now? He's in the prayer productive zone. The prayer is being answered. There you go. It's being answered. But it's a process. You want your prayer answered? Sometimes it's a what, y'all? It's a process. And sometimes you have to be willing to what? Go through the process. Now, here's the thing. It said that he wrestled with the man. Now, in this, Jacob has a choice. Jacob can either wrestle with the man, or he can do what? He can cop out and run away. Don't run away. Stay right there.
Yes, Lord.
Don't run away. Stay right there. Where you going? Where you going? Stay right where you stay there. Work it out. Yes.
Oh, my God, my God.
Huh? You got to learn how to work it out. And when he saw, well, now verse 25. Now, watch this here. Now, when he, the man, saw that he was not winning. So Jacob, in this prayer productive zone, did have some what? Upswing. Because this man saw that he wasn't winning every round. So there may be a couple of instances where he got the best of Jacob. There may have been a couple of instances where Jacob got the best of him. Oh, Lord, that's life right there. That's life right there. You ever had an area in your life just like that? On Monday, you got the best of it. On Tuesday, you got the best of it. On Wednesday, you got the best of it. And on Thursday, you thought you had it figured out. But, Lord, here come Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Boom, 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 boom. That thing, boom, knocked you down. Huh? When you in the prayer productive zone, some days are better than others. There are going to be some days where you're going to lose the battle, and ultimately you want to do what? You want to win the war.
Yes.
That's why in the NBA, you know, they don't just have one game to determine who's the champion. No, you play 82 games in a season. No, you're going to have some games to determine. You're going to have to go back and forth. That's why they have a 7 is the best out of 7. So the ultimate champion might lose a couple of games. But at the end, guess what? They might come out, what? 4-2. Winning 4 and lost 2. But they still come out, what? Champions. See, as Christians,
we
want the clean, we want the sweep. We want the sweep. But everything in life will never always be able to be sweet. You're going to have to take some hits. You're going to have to take some licks. You have to learn how to take a licking and keep on ticking. You want your marriage to be successful? Yeah, your spouse gonna get on your nerves. Absolutely. Just like your spouse gets on your nerves, that's how the children of Israel got on God's nerves. You want to know how to stay married? Study God's relationship with the children of Israel. That's a marriage. It's in there. He called them. He was the husband to the children of Israel. Yeah, he was. Yeah, they got on his nerves. Absolutely. But what? He worked it out. Learn how to work it out. So when he saw that he didn't prevail against Jacob, he brought out the big dogs. Got ready for a big old punch. Big old, so he hit Jacob in the thigh bone. Boom. Thought that was going to take it out. Lord have mercy. Listen, it left a scar, but it didn't completely destroy. There are some things in your life that you go through, it's going to leave scars, but you're still able to overcome it. And the scar is there as a testimony as to what God helped bring you through. But we don't want to talk about what God has helped us through. We do the church an injustice, thinking that the church is full of folk who ain't never went through nothing, they ain't never experienced anything. It's quite the contrary. It says the man touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh, and it was out of joint. Out of joint. It wasn't straight anymore. It was what? Crooked. Ah. That's in the prayer productive zone. Verse 26. Here we go. And he represents Jacob's past. Said to Jacob, what? Let me go. That's it, right? That's the answer to verse 11. Because you have to learn how to do what? Let go of your past.
Yes.
Jacob said, I will not let thee go except you what? So in other words, I'm going to get something out of this. I'm going to learn something. I'm not leaving this scenario empty-handed. I done wrestled with this thing. I done gone through this thing. I'm going to, God, show me what I'm supposed to get out of this. And his past said unto him, what is your name? Your past comes to impact your identity. Lord have mercy. Your past comes to impact your present. Not only your present, but it comes to impact your future. Your past comes to see if you know who you are. And Jacob said, my name is Jacob. And his past said, thy name shall be no more called Jacob, but what? Israel. Now, verse 28 represents what, y'all? He's getting ready to end. It's your point of exodus. It's your point of exodus. Exodus. And he said, call no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a friend has thou power with God and with man and has what? Watch this here. What we see here now is that Jacob is emerging now.